This is the Leadership School Podcast. From conflict resolution, boundaries, and customer service, we dive into what it takes to be an extraordinary leader.
Welcome back to the Leadership School Podcast. I am your host, Kyla Kofer, and this is episode 15. I'm really excited about our special guest today, Amber Palmer-Halma. She is a really dear friend of mine, and so this episode is really unique and meaningful to me because of our friendship. In this episode, you're going to hear a lot of vulnerability, authenticity, a lot of leadership lessons learned, and failures. It's going to be really fun to hear the trajectory of our friendship, and you're just going to get a lot of really great stories. So please join me in welcoming my dear friend, Amber Palmer-Halma, to the Leadership School.
Amber, thank you so much for joining me today.
It's my pleasure.
So I have been really excited to our interview. I don't call it an interview because it's going to be more like a conversation. But yeah. We have known each other for a really long time now. And I would love for you, if you remember, to tell the story of how we met, because I remember it very clearly because that totally changed my life. And I'm not saying that in a, I'm saying that in a very literal sense, because that meeting really set the stage for everything that happened in my life after that. So I would love to hear from you about how we met. And then let's just talk about some of our life and experience, and we'll just go from there.
We met on your campus, right?
Yeah.
When I was the road warrior for the Council for Christian Colleges and Universities, and you had returned from the Latin American Studies program, and I had asked if you might help me recruit your fellow students to go, right? Or yeah, so drop by the table and tell me about your experience.
Yeah.
You came to my table in like the student union building or something, I don't even know what it's called. And we ended up sitting there for probably at least an hour and a half, right? And yeah, we just talked and talked and talked and talked about your experience and the parts that had been challenging and the parts that had been like growth oriented and all these different elements. And we also talked about how you were getting ready to graduate and you didn't really know what to do. And so I gave you some of the same spiel I'd given a lot of other students about, like, well, here's some options for you. Have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? And then I don't remember, Kyla, if it was then or later that I was like, we're going to have an opening. You should apply.
Yeah. I don't remember. It was then. So actually, that was the second time we met. Because the first time we met, you came into my class, my Spanish class, and told me about the Latin American Studies program. And I applied in 2 days, which was like a record. You told me all about that program. And you're like, this is what you need to do. It's going to be hard, but you can do it. And that's why and followed up with you afterwards.
That's awesome. Yes. And so you applied to be the road warrior. And we brought you out to DC and we interviewed you. And I just kept thinking, like, I like her, but she doesn't have the maturity to do this job yet. Yeah. Like, we can't send her to campuses to represent us yet. You just graduated, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so Rich Gathrow said that I needed to take you to dinner because you should always break bread with people before you like give them hard news and tell you that we loved you, but we couldn't hire you.
Like, yeah, I actually forgot about that.
Oh, it was like the most stressful dinner that I've ever, I was so stressed about that dinner, but you were so gracious. Like, you are so gracious. You took the like feedback. You were disappointed, but you were like, I understand. And I was like, okay. And then we ended up having another opening. We needed someone to be a study abroad advisor and help our students like get to the programs. And so we called you up and we offered you the job and you took it.
Yeah, absolutely. I took it. But you know why it was so easy to be gracious in that moment when you were at the restaurant telling me that you were not going to hire me for this job? Because you did so with such compassion, and because you did so and it it was just so cool the way you were like, you're amazing. I'm not like telling you that you suck and that we don't want to have you here. It's just that this is not the right fit. Telling me, like you just said, I didn't have the maturity for those things. The fact that you would even say that to me now and just the way you would say it is honesty with compassion. That is one of the things among many things I really admire about you, because that is a requirement for leadership.
It should be a requirement for leadership. It is not always a requirement for leadership.
That's true.
But boy, it should be. And I had great models, right? So like Kimberly, who had been my boss at the CCCU, and Rich Gathrow, they had in very different ways, because they were very different people. They had both done that for me. Kimberly was very willing to say to me at times, you are really good at this, but you've got a growing edge here. You need to work on this. You need to. And so they had modeled that for me in some really, really great ways that made it easier for me to then try to do it too. But I remember throughout that entire conversation thinking, Rich Gathrow would say I'm saying too much. Rich Gathrow would say I'm saying too much, but I couldn't stop because I was so nervous.
I probably knew that, but you know, I don't even remember that conversation, honestly. What I remember is, was that when we went to the Cuban place? Because what I remember was sharing guacamole with you. Like that's all not sharing, because I had mono, so we didn't share, but I just remember having a meal with you. And that's all I remember, is just that we went to dinner together. And I have all of these mostly pleasant memories of you. Like when I say mostly, it's because there were some moments when we really didn't get along.
Yes. Yes. I didn't know how to lead. I mean, I'd never been a supervisor really. And so, and I think a lot of it was that you were so similar to me in some of the very best ways, but it meant that I didn't know how to help you.
Yeah.
Because then the areas where you still needed to grow were the areas where I still needed to grow. And I didn't know what to do there. And I didn't know at that time who to go to for help. Because we'd had the leadership change and my go-tos had kind of, they'd left the building.
Yeah, literally. Yeah.
And so I didn't know where to go. It's so funny because in the end, you and I both became really, really good friends with Marge. Yep. And we both sought Marge for advice and mentorship. And I think she probably advised us both similarly.
I'm sure she did.
And we both learned and grew from having her as a mentor, right? So I'm so thankful to her, and I know you are too. But I didn't know to go to her then. It took me like 2 more years to start going to Marge consistently. And if I'd started earlier, think about how much smarter I'd be.
Well, you're pretty smart, so yeah. I mean, let's just take a moment to like, I want to say something about Marge, but I also want to talk about mentorship, because I think that this is something going to be really key to our conversation. But you said gratitude, and I am so full of consistent gratitude for you, for that job, and for Marge, because Marge passed away in last year, and it was really hard for both of us, even though you had had a much more intense relationship with her, or a deeper relationship, because I had left and you were still there. And so you guys still interacted, but she was just a really remarkable person and such a willing and capable and kind and generous and all the wonderful words you've come up with, mentor.
Yes. Yes. And she was 76 when she died. So she was like 30 years older. And I called her my best friend. And she never cared that she was 30 years older. It never mattered to her. And it mattered so much to me because I knew she had so much wisdom in that, but she was a true friend. I mean, we laughed about things that you would not imagine laughing about with a 76-year-old woman, you know? Like,
yeah.
So she was a peer and a mentor. And I've tried so hard to do that with the people I've been able to work with, over the last like 10 years or even longer. I feel like it's okay to be both a peer and a mentor. Sometimes it doesn't go as well as you hope, yeah. But it still seems worth the risk. And I think when I look back on like my my graduate students who were who I got to supervise when I was at George Washington University, or even like the person who's been our nanny for this past year, she is both a friend and a mentee. And wow. It's a worthwhile investment for both of us.
Absolutely. And it's such a gift to both of you.
It is. Yes.
So tell me, like, what are some of your skills or your tips for doing that? Because I have never been able to master this. And you're so right. The peer and the mentorship, that's who Marge was. And that was one of her many, many, many gifts. But how do you do that?
Well, authenticity, which is so funny because I've been going through some assessments for my executive coaching program that I'm getting to do. And one of the assessments said that my number one value is authenticity. Mm. And I've been realizing how vital that is. And the trick to authenticity is that you have to let yourself be ugly. So I have to let people see the good, the bad, and the ugly. And Marge was willing to do that too. Like, one of the things that she shared with me often was some of the struggles that she'd had in her marriage. And I looked at their marriage and thought, this is like the marriage of my dreams. And it was the marriage of my dreams, but it was built on hard work. And she never shied away from sharing the hard work.
Wow. So, my eyes just got really big because, and I don't want this podcast to be all about Marge, so we'll move on in a second, but my eyes just got really big because I am so surprised to hear that. Just not that she was vulnerable, but that the marriage was such a struggle, because I never would have ever thought that.
She taught me so many, she shared with me so many things she learned in the counseling that they went to. And to know that they took the courageous step of going to counseling meant a lot to me and gave me courage. But to see that they were then willing to learn from it and apply it for more than 40 years was so empowering. Like, it just, and it was an amazing thing to see. So that was part of it. She also taught me how to run meetings, because I am very much like an ENFP, Myers-Briggs. Let's bring everyone together. Let's have a big conversation. I assume that everyone else wants to sit around and talk for an hour and a half. Marge helped me realize that different people bring different styles. And if I'm going to be my authentic self, then I can acknowledge that I love to sit around and have a big conversation. But I also need to acknowledge that there are people in the room who are hating every minute of that.
Yeah, I know. I'm with you though. I would rather just sit and have this hour long conversation. It sounds so wonderful.
Yes. For some people that is sheer torture, right?
Yeah. Yep.
And Marge really helped me see that they're not wrong. And I'm not either. But I need to authentically say, I'd love to talk for an hour and a half. It would be my pleasure to talk to you for an hour and a half. That's sheer torture for you, isn't it? Okay, so let's figure out another way. And especially when I was working with the graduate assistants, every year I'd get a new crop of 7 to 10 graduate assistants. And I realized pretty quickly that I was kind of like the Pentagon. And you know how they always say the Pentagon is always fighting the last war in the present war. And I was realizing that I was like supervising this year's group of interns based on what I had learned about myself from last year's. And whatever didn't go well with last year's, I tried to like correct for in this year's. And finally, after 3 years of that, I'm not the quickest learner, Kyla, but after like 3 years of that, I realized, and with Marge's help, it would go better if I would try to get to know each group for who they uniquely were. And if I would show them my authentic self and let them show me their authentic self, then we could together figure out the best ways to get work done.
So how did that change your groups?
It was awesome. It meant that at the very beginning, instead of bringing in like structures and rules and regulations, I tried to start with, these are the main things I need you to know. One of the things I need you to know is You are here in this position because you're the cream of the crop. But while you are in this position, you are the lowest man on the totem pole. So it will not be glamorous. And it will not always be you showing off your best, smartest self. It will sometimes be you moving boxes. But you need, I need you to do that with the humility and the grace and the professionalism as though you are presenting at a conference for 100 people, right? Like, so we talked a lot about that kind of stuff early on to try to lay the groundwork. And then I tried to get with each intern or graduate assistant individually within the first 2 weeks and have a one-on-one and try to start picking out some of the things that they liked and didn't like, and tried to ask really pointed questions about, like, what do you think I could do to best support you this year? What do you most want to get out of this year? Like those kind of questions to just have a sense of what it was. And sometimes it helped me see that their expectations were not going to be able to be met. Like, what you really want is a conference ready paper. I don't know that I can give you that, but let me make sure that you get to work mostly with this professor who is not doing the thing that you're most interested in, but who writes a lot of conference papers, because then you'll at least have your name on something. Like, and we could have those conversations about what can I give you and what am I going to have to ask from you to do it? And a lot of it was talking about what's realistic for what we can actually offer and what you can actually give, and trying to be as honest as I could be about what my powers were, which was that I didn't have a lot of power. Like, all I could do was say, I think we should set you up with this professor. I will go and make that introduction. They may say no. If they say no, we'll try another way. But I'll do my best to serve you. I may not be able to make it the absolute best thing, but if I'm honest with you about that and honest with you about what I need from you in return, we have a better chance of getting somewhere that's best for both of us. Does that make sense?
Yeah, you know, and it makes me think of a couple of episodes ago, I was talking with Amy Lafko, who used the term compassionate candor. Telling the truth, like telling someone, being honest, like what you were just doing, but doing so with compassion and not being a jerk about it, but also not trying to skirt around any issues. When you're just upfront with issues, you can be honest and you can have that compassion to go, I care about you, and so I'm going to do the best I can for you. But you also have to realize that there's going to be some compromise here.
Yes. And I think a lot of times, especially when you're newer in a job or in your career, that compromise is really hard.
Yeah.
Because it can feel like you're being asked to give up everything. Or it can feel like you're being pushed into a corner that you may not be able to get out of. Mm. So a lot of times with the graduate assistants, and even with like my students now in the classes that I teach at Belmont, I spend a lot of time talking about how they're seasons. Like, you're in seasons in life, and it's kind of, you're on a journey. It's all a process, but in this season, it's important for you to establish, you know, career goals. It's important for you to establish like your boundaries of what you are willing to give up and what you can't give up. Are you more mission driven or are you more financially driven? You might be mission driven, but you've got so many student loans, you've got to be financially driven. Like, how do you balance those things? This is the season when you're just starting out in your career or you're in graduate school or whatever. This is the season for figuring those things out. Now I'm in a different season. Now I'm in a season where the most important things to me are being able to be with my family, being able to do a job, do it well, feel like I offer something to an organization, and then leave it and not feel stressed when I'm not doing it. That probably will mean not as much financial gain, but it might mean more family gain. And so it's a different season. I think, like, when you're talking with people and you're willing to acknowledge that we may be in different places in the same room. You may be in this season and I may be in a different one. And as a result, we've got different perspectives and goals, and that's okay. we still need to have a mission that we're working toward together for the larger organization. We can figure out how we fit in that if we're willing to have those kinds of conversations. I love that part. When I get to have those kinds of conversations with people, I feel like those are the conversations that actually move the entire organization forward. Because it lets people be who they are. Like, one of my strengths finders that is not in my top five, but's close up there, is individualization. And I love getting to know each person's story and finding out what makes them so unique and figuring out how to highlight that for them, like bring that out in each person.
Well, it sounds like you've put a lot of effort into learning how to do that and surrounding yourself with mentors who did that well, and taking their lessons and watching their example and putting a lot of energy into learning to do that, because that was a priority for you.
Yes. Because I love it when people do it for me, right? Mm. I mean, it's a totally selfish thing. It's the best feeling in the world when I feel like someone has seen me for who I am. So then the best thing I could do for you is to see you for who you are and help you see how that connects to the larger mission of the organization.
Well, that's what we all want, right? Is to be known.
Yeah.
And that's part of leadership. When you're leading a whole bunch of people who just want to be known, if you don't take time to get to know them, then it's going to be hard to lead them.
Oh, man. And you know what I am seeing too? If you can just, if you can have from the beginning a little bit of faith that at least 98% of the people really want to contribute greatly. I'm sure there's some people, but for the most part, I don't think anyone comes into an organization going, I'm just going to suck them dry. You know?
Yeah.
I think most people come into organizations with this desire to contribute, to bring what they are and what they have to the greater good of the organization. And if you as a leader can have faith in that and like build your policies, build your culture around that faith, I think people would live up to that expectation most of the time.
You know, I've been talking a lot about people first, and that's just the term that's going around that is becoming kind of a movement that in business we put people first. And not only is that the humane thing to do, but it does increase your business and your growth or your nonprofit or whatever that you're doing, your mission, because you're all in it together. I'm excited about what you're doing. Yeah. So I like to talk about integrity a lot in this podcast. So let's just take a little bit of a turn, not too much, but I just want to know for you, what does it mean to you to lead with integrity?
It's a good question.
I think we've kind of been talking about it, you know, in saying how you have honesty when in your upfront conversations and authenticity, a lot of those things. Is there anything? Go ahead.
I think the other element that comes from leading with integrity is, for me, I do not believe that I should ask someone to do something that I would not be willing to do. Now, I may not be the best at it, right? Like, I can ask you to do it because you're better at it, or because when you look at the things that are on my plate versus the things that are on your plate, you're the better person to do it. But I should never ask you to do something that I myself wouldn't be willing to do.
Like that, I don't want to go do this project, so I'm going to pawn it off onto somebody else.
Mm-hmm. Or since I'm in communications, you know, why don't you figure out how to tell people why we're doing layoffs or why we're firing this person? Like you figure out how to schmooze it.
Yeah. So, what are some things that you do, as you're growing in your leadership? You have mentored and the peer mentorship, I'm circling back to this, because at times you've been my mentor and at times I've been yours, I think. And that's just friendship. But by having people always feeding into your life and not feeling like you have to be so independent that you have to know it all yourself or do it all on your own, but that you're always learning from people. And then you mentioned just quite a few things. So for you, what are some of those lessons that you really want to pass on in about leadership?
Start from an assumption of good. And you may get bitten by that. But go into new jobs, new situations, new employees working on your team, whatever it is, with the assumption that people are there to do good. And until they prove you wrong more than once, keep trusting that. And I'm trying to live that, and I'm trying to show that. I'm trying to teach that to my own kids. I'm trying to teach that to my students. We all have life happens moments, you know, when we miss a deadline or we don't do it as well as we hoped that we would. We turn in a draft that we know is not the level that it should be. Those kind of things. Have grace for those. Allow yourself to remember that you've also screwed up. Don't lower your expectations to the point where you're accepting crummy work, but have that assumption of good and allow for that mistake. We're all going to make mistakes. Make sure that you're not defined by your mistake, but by your reaction to it. And so I keep, that's what I try to teach people. That's what I try to live. I try to remind myself of that. I'm a woman, and I know that I have to be somewhat careful about this, but I tend to embrace the idea that it is never wrong to say you're sorry, in that it can open doors to conversations that can be a place for healing and growth. It's also okay to stand your ground. And I mean, I had an experience just recently where I realized that my boss would like me to agree with him on something that I just can't. And it's causing a rift. He's struggling to have, he does not like that I can't agree. And I've had to just say, I understand your perspective. I just can't share it, but here's all the communication things that you need to follow through on your decision. I am never going to be able to tell him that I agree with him. I just can't. I think it's a mistake, and I'm not probably going to be able to change my mind on that.
That goes back to your integrity.
It does.
Yeah. I mean, it would not be integrity. You would not have integrity if you were just trying to say what that person wanted to hear because they were in charge.
Yeah.
But I think it's really cool that you know your job, you know what your job is, and this is the decision your boss made. And so you can be clear about saying this is your boundary, right? You don't agree with the decision, but this person made the decision and your job is to make sure they have what they need. And so you're doing that, but you're also being honest and saying, I don't agree with this. So that's a hard balance to do. What do we agree with it and move forward, or is it ever something that it's so against our moral beliefs that we would say, absolutely, I'm not going to contribute to this at all? How do you make those decisions in a job?
I do it case by case, and I have left jobs because I could not handle the decisions being made. I had a boss who was a yeller, and he always picked someone each day to pick on. And it normally wasn't me, but I couldn't watch him. I just couldn't watch him pick on someone, a different person every day. I just couldn't do it. And so when it got to the end of my probationary period, we sat down and I said, I should probably start by saying that probation goes both ways. And I've decided that I'm going to leave. I don't want to stay here.
Wow. Good for you. That must have been hard because that's financial income. I mean,
it was, and it was the day that Lehman Brothers declared bankruptcy. So it took me 3 years to get another job, but, it was still the right decision. I mean, for me, it was. Now, I'll be honest, everyone else stayed. All these other people that everyone else stayed. And I kept thinking, you're all miserable. Why are you all staying? They looked at the situation and they assessed it differently. And on the one hand, when I could not find work and was like cleaning out the Council for Christian College's storage unit just to have enough money to pay rent. I wondered if I'd made a big mistake, but I couldn't stay. I mean, like, I couldn't do it, even though other people could. And I sometimes wished that I could have stayed for the paycheck or whatever, but I knew me well enough to know I just couldn't do it.
Wow. And yeah.
I think that it would be really hard for me if I had a situation where someone who was reporting to me came in and said, like, I am leaving because I don't want to work for you. And, you know, my boss is always saying people don't leave jobs, they leave bosses. And I keep thinking, like, have I done that to people? Have I been that boss that they just couldn't stay with anymore? And I think the hard part is it's not about making sure everyone likes me. I mean, I would like to be liked. I'm not going to lie. I really like it when people like me. But I don't necessarily know that I need you to be my best friend, but I need you to have enough respect for me as a leader that I am not the reason, my leadership is not the reason that you would leave.
Or that if there's something going on, let's find a solution. Let's find a resolution. Let's work it out together, or have that you've started from the beginning of working with this person where you can work things out.
Yes, that's my hope. I really
it is hard to work things out. Marriage has really taught me a lot about doing that.
Yeah.
And let's be honest, my husband is the one who's better at it. He is the one who will come and say, we need to talk about this. And I'll be like, I'm not talking.
But you keep going. You keep going. Yeah. That's what matters.
But I do talk about it afterwards. He just has to be the one to kind of push me into it. And
yeah.
What's funny is because I'm really willing to jump into conflict if it doesn't affect me.
Yeah.
I really have no problem like saying
you're
a things.
Justice warrior. Like
I really
are,
am.
Yeah.
But if it affects like me on my soul, like me internally in my bubble, it's pretty tough.
I can totally understand that. Yeah. I mean, that's a level of vulnerability that nobody's going to be like, let's just jump right in on that one. You know, I mean, it takes a lot of courage to do that.
It does. You know, I was thinking about this earlier when I was thinking about our call, about the boldness that it takes to be a leader, and that how boldness looks and means different. It doesn't always have the same definition, I don't think. I think you can be bold and quiet, or but there is some boldness that comes with taking on the responsibility of being in a leadership position.
Yes. Yes. And I've always joked that, like, if you need an opinion, come to me because I've got lots, kind of thing. But I actually think that has been one of the gifts that God gave me, that I'm a verbal processor. And so, and thankfully God also made me pretty articulate. So as someone who needs to like think it out loud to really think it, it's been a thing I can bring to teams, that I'm the one who is willing to say, like, I don't know if that's going to work, y'all, because blah, 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 blah. But at the same time, I'm like, but I'm not willing to just shut it down. Like, this is a horrible idea, but let's see if we can fix it, has always kind of been one of the things that I've enjoyed doing. And when I'm in jobs where that's encouraged or invited, I thrive. If you are willing to let me have an idea that's half-baked and then bake it together, one of my colleagues now likes to say, I'm going to put this out there, but this cake is not baked. When she says that, I feel my heart lighten because I'm like, ooh, I can help you bake it. You know,
that's great.
It's such a fun thing for me. And she's so empowering when she does that. I can see several of us just get really excited because it means she's inviting us into that process. And it's so empowering to be invited in. And so when I lead things, I want to invite people in. Now, I've got to let them come in their own unique way. Not everyone wants to help bake a half-baked cake. But figuring out how different people can offer different things, that is like the most exciting thing to me. So I feel like I'm saying the same thing over and over, But when I think about like integrity, when I think about authenticity, it really is this process of just making sure that you're like opening the door for each person to bring who they are to the table. To just
How do you respond? I mean, I guess when you're the leader that you're the one who gets to open that up. But when you're in a position where you have a boss or somebody else leading you and you're, I mean, because we're a lot more alike than I realized when you said that earlier today. I was like, oh, we really are a lot alike. But I have struggled when I have been that person kind of doing the pushback. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I've been in a room where I'm the only person pushing back. Yeah. And I feel really awkward. I feel really like people are just really annoyed with me. They want me out of the room. They, and some of this is my own imposter syndrome or my own not good enoughs. But have you dealt with that? And if so, how have you dealt with that?
Sometimes more successfully than others, to be completely honest. So I'm going to use specific examples of George Washington University because I was there for 7.5 years. And the first 5 years were awesome. And they were partly awesome because I was on a team that the boss of the team, she was actually fine with me having that role of like being the one who like kind of pushed back, but also found solutions. And she really just kind of got out of the way and let me do that. And she let me sit at the table. And, you know, I was staff among all these faculty. And in a lot of environments in higher ed, I would have been considered a very class citizen. But she never treated me like one. And as a and actually, the faculty at the track number school, they just never treated me like one. They just let me be at the table. And I'm so thankful for that. And I grew in my own confidence so much from just being able to have a seat at the table and offer advice. And I sat in on like even the executive council meetings. And I was a legit source of information in those meetings. It was just great. I mean, it was such an empowering experience for me. And I loved it. I'm so thankful for it. After about 5.5 years, I actually decided that I wanted the opportunity to have a legit seat at the table, not just a de facto one, but an actual seat at the table. The boss who had so empowered me was going to be leaving the director position. And it became really important to me that I still have value and still have worth and be able to provide what I had been providing all along and have recognition for it. I really wanted recognition for it. And it was a lot harder because I was told in a lot of different ways that my perspective was really valued, but I was never going to get it officially. And I was hurt by that. I was offended that they wanted it, they needed it, they didn't want me to leave the job, they needed me there. They made me the de facto like deputy director of the department. If anyone had a question, they came to me, whether it was academic or anything, they came to me. But when I asked for like the legitimacy, I was told no. And I couldn't get over that I wasn't allowed to have it in reality, only behind the scenes. So I'm still figuring out and I don't have an answer, Kyla.
So I have a couple of thoughts on that. The first is I'm actually glad that you don't really have a solution for it because, you know, I think we tend to see leaders as having it all figured out, but we don't always. And I have no idea. That's why I asked you that question because I haven't figured that out. And so it's nice to go, okay, we're all still just figuring stuff out. We have this desire to be better and to make ourselves better and to grow and to learn. And I think that's what a lot of leadership is just this desire to always be changing and transforming and growing in that and even trying to figure it out.
One part of me that thinks like, Amber, you're 45, like you've got 20 to 25 years left of work. wouldn't it be great if you kind of knew what you were going to do and like could just do it for the next 20 years? And there's another part of me that's like, oh, come on, you're never going to be good at that. Like, I'm always going to be trying to figure out different ways to do things. And I mean, one of the things that happened at GW, I loved the organization. I loved the students. I loved everything about it. There came a point at the fifth year when I was like, I am out of creative ways to say that public service education matters. I don't know how to say this anymore. The message hasn't changed, but I've lost the ability to creatively talk about it because I'm burned out.
Yeah.
And so figuring out there comes like for me to like be constantly learning or whatever, it does mean I probably am not going to be able to stay at the same organization forever and ever and ever unless what I am doing drastically changes in that time. Because when you're the communicator and you're in charge of the writing and the website and the social media and all this stuff, there comes a point, no matter what it is, when you're just out of ways to talk about it.
No, that makes sense. That's how I feel like, when my toddler is asking me question after question about the same thing. Yeah. Oh, wow. Well, I've got three, maybe four specific questions I really want to ask you. The first one on those veins is decision-making. What is kind of your process for those big decisions and changes? Like when you chose to leave your job, when you've chosen to say yes to a job or just major life changes, how kind of walk us through, if you can, walk me through that process of this is a really big decision and I want to make the right one. And how do you go about that?
So it's so funny with all these different assessments that I've been doing. One of them was emergenetics, which I'd never heard of before, but it turns out a lot of people have done emergenetics. And in my emergenetics profile, it talked about how I tend to use my gut. And at first I was like, use your gut. What does this even mean? And then they started explaining. I was like, that. But so I definitely do let emotion be a clue for me. And so if I find myself really feeling like I do not want to go to work today, I do not want to get out of bed, I do not want to do this, I am like really physically wanting to run away, that is a good clue to me that I am not going to be able to stick it out here much longer. Right?
Like, yeah. Yeah.
Now, my husband, whom I adore, he can keep going. He can have that and just power through. And I really respect that about him because I'm not very good at that. So that's been one. As soon as I start having those, I seek input. So as a verbal processor, I'm so thankful for the collection of amazing, mostly women, but people who have come around me throughout my entire life and the fact that I've been able to hang on to so many of them. My best friend from high school, who became the photographer at my wedding, who I just saw in Waco a few weeks ago. I mean, like, we both work in communications, and so she's, like, the first one I go to when it's a job. Like, I don't know if I can do this. I'm not sure if I'm actually prepared. I still go to her today to get her insights. I have those people that I go to consistently. I try to, like, express where I'm at and hear what they have to say. And they always help me formulate my own thoughts, like consistently.
Let me ask you this. Do you do that same process when you're making decisions for your job, not whether to like to stay or to leave, but like if, you know, something major is coming up at work, are you seeking feedback from the people you work with, your friends and or do you just plunge ahead and make a decision?
Oh no, I'm not a good plunger. Like really, I really don't have a thought until I've said it out loud. And so as such a verbal processor, I'm seeking ways always to think things through. I love making connections between things that maybe don't seem connected. So a lot of times I'll hear a story on NPR and I'll think, oh, they're talking about, you know, a new communication technique. And I'll be like, we should use that to try to recruit. Right? Like we need to build our recruitment funnel so we can use this new technique I heard about in a marketplace story or whatever, things like that. But even with that, it's like I'm having a conversation with the radio or I'm having a conversation with the different people I've collected through the years. I run things by folks I knew in grad school when it comes to communication stuff, because they've got much better ideas than I do. And so I like to get different input for in the work job questions, and then also how to handle like vocational questions. Who am I? Where do I fit? Am I actually fulfilling my purpose? Am I stuck in a rut, or how would I get out of it? You know, I'm at a point right now where I'm realizing I want to pivot. I want to use communications to forward relationships. And that's very different from being a director of communications. I don't know how to do that pivot, but for the last several years, I've been having tons of conversations with all of those folks to have a better sense. And even, you know, I add new people in. Like, I had coffee today with my counterpart at another charter school, and I was getting her input on it, because I am not sure how best to make these kind of pivots, but with enough data, something will become clear, I think. So that's a lot of it for me.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. I don't want to interrupt you.
But I love to take all those, and eventually it starts to form a cohesive thought, and then I can come up with a plan.
And from there you are, because you're making your own decision. What I love about this conversation is just hearing how well you know yourself. You have invested a lot of time, effort, and energy just to know yourself better so you can do better. And I think that's really cool. So you know that you're a verbal processor. That doesn't mean you can't make a decision. It means that you're collecting points on the data plot to be able to filter your decision through and to help you process, which is really, I think it's a really fun way to make decisions.
Well, I think they're better decisions than what I could make on my own. That's not true of everyone. Like, I have seen people, our friend Rich Potts takes in so much information, and he works it all out in his head. And then when he says something, it was always so well reasoned and so thought. And I was like, wow, my brain can't do that. Like, if I'm trying to make decisions the way that Potts does, they're going to be crummy decisions.
Okay. So one thing you mentioned was actually the next question I was going to ask you. I have noticed that you are extremely good at building and maintaining relationships and building people up. You have maintained relationships with people for decades, and you might go visit a town or a city and go, hey, I know somebody here. I'm going to connect with you. And it's an actual connection. It's not just, oh yeah, I saw them on Facebook. It's like, you've actually connect and you care about them. So how do you manage to keep in touch with so many people, communicate with, and build those relationships? You make it look so easy. What is the secret for this?
Well, that's what gives me energy. So, it's funny because like these last several weeks have just been so crazy that I feel like I've dropped the ball on almost all of my relationships. And I know my tank is on empty, because each of those kinds of conversations, they're just a filler. They fill me up. They just, it seriously does. And that's how I have the energy to do the work that I have to do every day. So anytime I can feel like I'm having a real conversation. If we're just trying to have small talk, that is the most draining thing in the world to me. But to have a real conversation with someone. So the goal is always to get to the real. It will just give me so much energy. And so the relationships that I let go are the ones that feel like a drain, because the people aren't willing to be vulnerable with me the way that I'm vulnerable with them. And that's okay. You know, like, not everyone has the same level of vulnerability. Those folks, to me feels like surface, and it may not, it just feels that way to me, but the surface conversations, the surface relationships, I cannot do. And the older I get, the less tolerance I have for those.
Yeah.
But if I can really connect with you and find any way that we can, then I will keep you forever, because any minute I get to spend with you builds my tank of energy.
Well,
so it's actually self-serving.
everything I think we all, any of us ever does is self-serving in some way. I mean, altruism, is that really even a thing? Yeah. but you know, like, but when you do that, you're not just, how do I say it? You're not just taking, because hey, come to me and fill my tank up. No, you are always giving in those relationships.
Because it doesn't work. It wouldn't work. If you're just taking it, it doesn't work. It has to be a give and take, right? Because, and the worst is like on the times when I'm really stressed or something, and I like, you call and I just, you know, like word vomit, like, this is what's happening and blah, 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 blah. And then at the end of that, something happens and you're like, hey, I have to go. And I didn't get to hear about how you are. I actually, in those circumstances, I know myself well enough. No, I'm going to hang up feeling worse.
Interesting. Yeah.
So part of the process for me is that I've got to hear your story. Now, I may have to tell mine first because it's, you know, like right there on the top of my, to my tongue, and I just got to get it out. But if I don't also have that chance to hear you, it doesn't work for me to fill me up. I can't just get rid of my stuff. I've got to take in yours.
Sounds like communications was a pretty good career for you.
Yeah.
So I have two more thinking about them, and I'm wondering if you'd want to have another conversation with me about them. And I'll tell you what they are. Things like, you've done a whole presentations before on media bias, and I'd love to talk about some of that expertise. But it is kind of late, and so I want to respect our time. And maybe would you be willing to come back and have that conversation with me sometime? And
absolutely, you know, I can talk about that stuff forever.
Awesome. And then the other one is like keys to communicating and discourse with civility and listening. Because part of that, I think we already talked about in talking about like actually seeing and hearing a person, that you've also been trained on how to do some of that. So I would love to do this again. Can we do it again?
I would too. It was really fun.
You are intentional about being authentic, but I can clearly hear that from the way that you're talking about your leadership and how you've learned to be a leader, and in the things that you've done well and haven't done well. And you don't fear the things you haven't done well. You've just taken them as, well, this is me, this is how I've learned, and we just go on. And that's really cool.
Yeah. Sometimes it would be good, I think, if I were a little more fearful, and like, I think that the challenge I face, I've got to be willing to say, this is me right now, but I could get better at this, right? And sometimes I think my tendency is to be like, this is me, take me or leave me. And that's probably not the best, right? Like, I've got to find a way to say, like, I'm actually not that great at, I'm really good at coming up with ideas. I'm not always the best at follow through. So when it comes to like work stuff, when it comes to relationships, I'm pretty good at follow through. When it comes to work stuff, I can let things fall away. So instead of being like, yeah, this is just who I am, I've got to make sure I'm like, this is who I am, but I can get better.
Get better, but also knowing, I think part of that is knowing, okay, I'm really not doing so well at this area, and not being like, oh, I suck, or I'm just a terrible person,
right.
But yeah. Going, okay, this is something that I'm having a hard time with, so I need to find a way to fill this in. Otherwise, we're going to have a disaster on our hands, you know?
Yeah. That's true.
Thank you so much for listening to this podcast. I truly mean it when I say that I'm honored that you would spend time listening to the things that I have to say. You can support me by subscribing to this podcast, or by telling your friends, family, coworkers about it, and also by letting me know what you think. It really helps me to know what you like, what you don't like, things that you want to hear about, learn about, how I can share my expertise with you. I am here for you, to serve you. Again, thank you so much for listening, and let me know how I can continue to support you being the awesome leader that you are.